In this part of the course, I will discuss three critically important tools in the toolbox of any Java developer. In fact, what I will teach you in this section will improve you as a developer in any high-level programming language, as the concepts here run far deeper than even the scope of programming languages. In this video, I will talk about what I like to call the theory of abstractions. My goal is to get you to understand philosophically what an abstraction is, as this knowledge is critically important to using inheritance, interfaces, and abstract classes effectively. In subsequent videos, I will show you real-world examples and problems I have solved with these tools, and explain in clear and simple language when each tool is appropriate. Since concepts in computer science are built upon mathematical and logical observations of reality, we as programmers spend our time modeling different aspects of reality in a very concrete way. That is, in code. These same concepts pop up in all different fields of study and work, and that is good for two reasons. Firstly, becoming a good programmer will make you better in all kinds of different ways outside of the field, assuming you can employ the lessons you've learned. Secondly, it means we can learn from other, simpler examples and fields which do not have tendencies to rely upon extraordinary amounts of jargon. I mention this so that you can understand why this whole lesson will seem non-technical in nature. Once we get to the technical and practical stuff, I am confident you will already understand what we are trying to achieve in a very clear way. To begin, let me share a simple definition of an abstraction outside of the field of programming. An abstraction is a less detailed representation of a part of reality. Rather than spending a bunch of time breaking this definition down verbally, let us look at some examples of abstractions in daily life. Suppose you are traveling to an area and you have heard that it is a habitat of a particularly deadly kind of snake. Not wanting to take unnecessary risks, you wish to learn more about the snake. One way to become capable of identifying this snake would be to hire a guide to help you find one. However, while supporting the local economy is great, you could also just search for some images of the snake online. An image of a snake is an abstraction. They have enough details about a part of reality, in this case, a snake, to give you information that can save your life. Here's another example. Let us say that you have a child and you take that child to the zoo. The child is particularly fascinated by bears and asks you if he or she can have one. Now, outside of Russia, it is not common to encourage your child to play with a real bear because that can be very dangerous. Neither wanting your child to come to any harm nor to be completely disappointed, you settle for buying a stuffed bear. The stuffed bear is, of course, an abstraction of a real bear. It has enough detail to keep your child happy and safe. Now that you have an idea of what an abstraction is, I encourage you to take a moment to consider how they are such a fundamental part of reality that they give rise to the ability of information processing systems, such as computers or human brains, to actually function. Computers use binary digits to represent whatever kinds of abstractions we tell them to. The human brain uses electrical impulses and chemicals to represent more detailed abstractions, such as sounds, images, emotions, etc. In summary, the ability to model or represent different aspects of reality, keeping enough details to still be useful, is arguably as important as the physical reality which these abstractions are based upon. As you'll see in subsequent lessons, they are just as important for designing good programs.